For the price of this, you could buy 6 of these, but which one do you really need for your project? We're going to compare our $6,000 professional level Peel 3 3D scanner to the most accessible option and one that you already have, a smartphone. We'll also look at a third option, the Einstar Vega, that bridges the gap in cost and performance. We've taken a few scans for different use cases with each scanner, so we'll run through the scanning experience and the results, including how accurate and useful the scan is and where each of the scanners excels. You can also download the scan files from a link in the description so you can take a look for yourself and get a better feel for how the scans actually differ. In the end, all three devices ultimately produce a digital 3D model by collecting data from physical objects like car parts, engine bays, body panels, and so on, or environments like workshops or even racetracks. The technology used to capture this data differs between the scanners. The Einstar Vega and the Peel 3 both use an infrared VCSEL light source and are what we'd call structured light scanners. They project a light pattern onto the surface of the object and analyze how this pattern is distorted to figure out the shape of the surface. Smartphone scanning works a bit differently, using what's referred to as photogrammetry, essentially taking lots of photos of an object from all different directions and stitching them together to generate a 3D model. That said, smartphones with LiDAR also incorporate VCSEL light sources and use what's referred to as time of flight. This is where the scanner measures the time it takes for the light to travel to the object's surface and be reflected back to the sensor to understand the 3D geometry of the object and then build the 3D model. This tech can all get very confusing, and while it is good to understand it if you're doing a lot of 3D scanning, it's not going to stop you from getting started. In the end, the final output after some post-processing is going to be a 3D mesh file, which we can use for our CAD work, 3D printing, or simply as a 3D visual model. The processing for the Einstar and the Peel 3 both use dedicated software packages, while the smartphone, unsurprisingly, uses apps. So let's look at our first scan of our RX-7 engine bay, and for an example, we'll assume we're taking the scan to design a strut tower brace, a project in reach of any home enthusiast. The benefit of a 3D scan here is that we don't need to spend as much time taking measurements. We can be sure it clears everything in the engine bay, and just as importantly, looks the way that we want before spending money to produce it. So let's look at the scanning experience starting with the iPhone. And in this case, we were using an iPhone 15 Pro and the Kiri Engine app. For this scan, we actually used pure photogrammetry with no LiDAR. We actually found that the LiDAR doesn't seem to help. And in fact, none of the LiDAR scanning modes are suitable for an engine bay. This also means that you can use any smartphone, you don't need a new one with LiDAR, and the way that we used the app was completely free, so you can go straight out and try this for yourself. The scanning process is easy and only takes a minute or so. We just start the scan and then move around the target, pointing our phone at it from all directions. The app can automatically take the photos for us. The main considerations you need to keep in mind are just like taking any photo. Ensure that the subject is well and evenly lit, and since it's building a 3D model off the photos alone, shadows or reflections could cause issues. Then it's on to processing, where we have limited control over the settings, and it usually takes about 30 to 60 minutes to process a scan of this size. Next, we tried the Einstar Vega, something we'll label as a prosumer level scanner. This is an awesome bit of kit where, just like our phone, we can work completely wirelessly and use the built-in display for all our initial work. Since the scan is relatively big, we use the fast mode, and even on the max resolution, the scanning experience is great. Smooth and easy. Processing a scan of this size still takes some time, about 15 minutes or so, and then from the built-in touchscreen we can do some basic cleaning of the data and a simple alignment to the coordinate system, which is a helpful step when it comes to using the scan later on in our CAD software. Finally, our pro level scanner, the Peel 3, which takes longer to get set up with the laptop and all the cords. Being tethered to the laptop now feels rather inconvenient after using the other two options. Once scanning though, it's fairly smooth and easy. Better than most cheaper scanners I'd used, although not as easy and efficient as the Vega. Once we've taken the scan, the Peel CAD software, which is an extra expense, is where we notice a big difference. We've got a lot of post-processing power, being able to clean and edit the mesh, and then extract entities from the scan data. Or in other words, geometrical features like planes from flat surfaces or cylindrical forms. Then we can use these to get perfect alignment to the coordinate system or also check the accuracy of our scan data. If you want to add these skills to your toolbox, then take a look at our automotive CAD package, which includes our 3D scanning, 3D modeling, and 3D printing courses. We walk you through every step of the way from never having touched a scanner before to completing complex scans and using them in CAD software to design parts for your car and then bring those designs to life. So what about the results? How good are the scans from each scanners? Let's look at them in our CAD software, running it back in reverse order and starting with the PL3. As you might expect, the results are decent. There's some missing data from hard to capture areas. Had I spent much more time scanning the engine bay, I could have filled this in to some extent, but it's nothing that would stop us from designing a strut tower brace. If we zoom in on the scan, we can see that the resolution is relatively good. The edges of the finer details are quite crisp. Using the mesh section sketch tool to create some references, we can measure between the center of the strut towers and get a measurement of 929.4 millimeters. And the real thing should be about 930 millimeters. That's about a 0.06% or 0.6 millimeter error in this case. So it's fair to say we've got plenty good enough accuracy to design our strut brace. Next is the scan from the Vega, which has about the same amount of missing data from the hard to capture areas. This isn't surprising as both the scanners are using essentially the same technology to capture the data. The software seems to have smoothed the scan more, even though it was processed on fine resolution with minimal smoothing. So at first glance, this makes it look a bit cleaner. But when we zoom in, it's lacking in resolution compared to the peel scan. The edges of the finer details just aren't as crisp. This really just makes it harder to pick up on features, but in reality, it's still relatively good. The same measurement between the strut tower centers gives us 930.03, so we're right on the money. And in this case, the accuracy of the scan from the Vega is actually more than that of the peel. In the end, another useful scan for our application. Then we have the smartphone scan, and with the texture turned on, everything looks awesome. But the trick here is that the color texture adds some definition to the scan as we see it. When we turn that color texture off and zoom in, we actually see that it's quite a big step down in resolution when we look at the edges of the detailed features. The other key consideration is that smartphone photogrammetry isn't actually taking into account a known measurement. So the smartphone scan needs to be scaled to the correct size when we bring it into our CAD software. We do this by taking a measurement from the mesh and comparing it to a known physical measurement like the strut top spacing and then using the scale mesh tool to adjust accordingly. This way we know that measurement is accurate, but does this mean that the rest of the scan is accurate? A good way to check this is to look at another known physical measurement, like the PCD of the 3 strut top bolts. I've taken a physical measurement and I know that this PCD should be 110 millimeters. Using another mesh section sketch on the phone scan, I'm getting within 0.4 millimeters of this, so around 0.4%. So in the end, good accuracy once scaled. Not great resolution, but good enough to pick up on the strut tower bolts and the surfaces, and with some extra care, we can design a strut tower brace that we're sure clears everything in the engine bay. This is all great for relatively big scans and designs that don't need to be overly precise. But what happens if we're scanning something more precisely machined to design a part that requires more accuracy? For example, a Honda B18C Type R engine block. Again, the scan from our smartphone lacks resolution, so much so that in this case, it's probably not useful for anything that needs to bolt up to an engine block. One of the key issues here is capturing bolt holes with good resolution, and a trick that we like to use is to use a bolt or a stud in that hole to get a more defined hole location. That said, the scan can still be used for visual references or checking clearance, but anything critical will need to be backed up with physical measurements. The reality is that photogrammetry is more suited to large-scale scans. It actually works great if you want to quickly scan your workshop to plan a new layout, but it's difficult to get crisp details on any small parts. For the Einstar Vega, we took this scan on the HD mode, which is a lot less efficient than the fast mode, but it does lead to a slightly nicer scan, which is really clean and crisp. After measuring the cylinder bores with a ball gauge and micrometer at 81.7 millimeters, we found the scan to be around 0.4 to 0.8 millimeters off, or between 0.5 to 1%. We also know that the bore spacing is 90 millimeters, and we're on average within about half a millimeter of this. And finally, the PL3, which really shines with mechanical parts like this, although it's still difficult to capture data from the deeper parts of the block. Again, that's just a compromise of structured light scanning and an area where a laser scanner would help. We can extract all the entities in Fusion, but the features in the PLCAD software and its ability to work with mesh files makes extracting entities really easy and also more precise. The edges of the scan are very slightly more crisp than the scan from the Vega, but there's also slightly more noise on the surface texture. This small difference likely comes down to the mesh smoothing during processing, and it's something that we could address if it was a problem. The accuracy of the scan is where the main difference lies though. The PL3 gives us more consistent measurements of the cylinder bores all within 0.3 millimeters or less than 0.5% of the nominal dimension. And the bore spacing is even better, within about 0.1 millimeters. So we've seen the results. Let's try to summarize this information. What are the benefits of smartphone scanning? Or what would be the times where I'd pick up a smartphone to take a 3D scan? For one, you probably already have one in your pocket, and there's free apps available, so you can get started right away with no extra investment. It's obviously a super convenient approach that takes minimal time to set up. The results are good enough for certain uses, and with some extra care, it's possible to design real parts for your projects. The other thing to note is that this form of photogrammetry is actually really good at taking large scans like rooms or environments. Then we have the Einstar Vega, our prosumer level scanner. It is a significant step up in investment, but at under $2,000, we think it punches well above its weight. As far as dedicated scanners go, it's about as convenient as it gets, and its ease of use means we're much more likely to pull it out and scan something. The reality is, it gets you most of the way to a pro-level scanner and will give you a better experience in some cases, without such an investment. The accuracy and functionality is going to be more than enough for most of the work that we do on our project cars. However, if you are doing this work professionally and can justify the extra expense or need the extra precision, then the fact is a pro-level scanner like our PL3 will still give you a better scan with more accuracy. The setup is much less convenient, but the software does provide a lot of functionality. Again, we don't think this is the answer for most enthusiasts, but it does have its place.